That's an inside joke because we work together on Lost.
For those of you who didn't know that. Woo!
I played her husband. She drugged me and left me for dead. You don't know, I could have died. Choked on my tongue. Maybe I'm allergic to carpet lint. On the floor. You know how that goes.
At least I left you with a necklace.
I did. I have the necklace, so I still keep that. Anyway, welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming down.
I'm excited to be here. I think this is going to be fun, because nobody ever lets me talk to the fans. They always say that there's got to be a mediator, and, you know, we have to protect you from the fans. Like, you guys are going to suck my blood, or eat
That's a different panel.
Drug me and leave me for dead.
Totally different panel. We have a little bit in common. I don't know if you know this.
Well, we were married, so.
Aside from that,
right.
You were born in.
Canada!
More specifically. Yeah, Alberta.
You guys are getting closer and closer and closer.
Fort Saskatchewan, Alberta. Right outside of Edmonton, where I'm from. I once stopped for gas in Fort Saskatchewan. I was lost. Didn't even mean for that to happen. I was lost, and I had to stop for gas in Fort Saskatchewan. At the time...
And while I was there...
He
noticed this really cute, freckle-faced, green-eyed girl.
A rare beauty doing oil changes on big rigs.
I love it when people do their research.
But you didn't stay in Fort Saskatchewan for very long. Oh, good. We have a little scoochie thing for you.
Oh, hey, Zach. That's really kind of awesome.
But you didn't stay in Fort Saskatchewan for very long.
Who are these people? Sorry, I'm Canadian. We don't follow that sport.
Baseball's a lot like hockey without the skates or the action.
Or the skill. I'm never going to work again. They're going to throw me out of the country.
You didn't stay in Fort Saskatchewan very long. You moved from there to?
Do you want the whole... I moved a lot. I went to 5 different elementary schools, so I might bore you if I started from the beginning.
Trouble with
but
the authorities?
But I did...
Gotta keep moving.
Move to Kelowna. Kelowna, British Columbia. Is this what you need? Do you need me to prompt you?
I need this for me.
Okay, tell me, where is the connection with Kelowna?
My father used to golf in Kelowna. We used to camp outside of Kokanee Springs. And I would collect golf balls from this stream that ran off the golf course towards the lake, and I would sell them at the campsite.
And one time when he was selling them at the campsite... This pretty little green-eyed, freckle-faced girl.
Stole my money. You didn't last in Kelowna very long either. You moved from there to?
Abbotsford.
Why?
Exactly.
Abbotsford, population, what, like?
At least 6.
Six or 8.
At the most.
The sign for population is like a little flip chart. You have to get, when someone leaves town, they flip it back, and they flip it over when you come back. Abbotsford to?
Kelowna.
Back to Kelowna?
Mm-hmm.
And then to?
Vancouver.
Finally.
Just tell me what you want to hear.
Vancouver, the most beautiful city Canada has to offer, coming from an Edmontonian right now. One day... You get a phone call for an audition for a TV show called Lost.
That took a long time to get here. Really?
Yeah.
Yes, I did. Yes, I was in Vancouver. I got a phone call for an audition for a show called Lost.
And you said, what's the worst that could happen?
If I'm honest with myself, I actually said, this sounds stupid.
That's fair.
I did. I thought it sounded silly. And I didn't know it was going to be, you know, amazing.
What was your first clue that, oh my God, I think maybe this is pretty big?
Comic-Con.
Really?
Comic-Con 2004. The show had not aired yet. And myself, Matthew Fox, and Dominic Monaghan, and J.J. Abrams, and Damon Lindelof arrived to Comic-Con. Oh, hi, Brianna. Hi. Arrived to Comic-Con to a room like 7 or 8 or 9 times this size that was standing room only. And it had never aired on television. And we all kind of gulped and went, oh, God, okay, this is a big thing.
You were right. That was a big thing.
No, the con fans were right.
They were right.
They were right. They knew.
Standing room only, that's a fire hazard.
Not a problem today.
If there is a fire in here, towards the back, leave in an orderly fashion. Here at the front, I'm going to take this chair, bolt it right through that window. You follow me. Evangeline, you're on your own. Evangeline, that's a lot of syllables. People don't call you Evangeline, do they?
Why wouldn't they?
Because I remember on set, everybody called you something else. They had a little
nickname. Why are you doing that?
This is all I've got.
I think we got to go to the fans. All right, let's put that question to the audience. What do people call me?
That's totally true. Does someone have their hands on a microphone already? Who has it? Who has the microphone? Who?
I was over just kidding. Here. You can keep asking me questions.
I got tons. We can spread them out.
Okay, all right.
Let's go to this gentleman in the corner.
Hello. Oh.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
I'm great. What's your name?
My name's Keith.
Hi, Keith.
I was just wondering if you could talk about your experience working on The Hobbit.
Ooh.
Legally?
Whatever you can.
Legally, no. Unofficially, I'm sure Peter Jackson will never see this because it's not streaming to the whole world right now. My experience on The Hobbit. Well, I mean, can you be a little more specific? There were so many aspects of my experience on The Hobbit. What specifically, Keith, are you looking for?
Just any information about working with Peter Jackson.
That's good. That's okay. Helpful. Okay.
Peter about your character?
Peter Jackson is, as you all know, a butterball. And the most lovable butterball in the world. He always has leftover, saved for later food somewhere on his person. And I always made sure to go and groom him like an orangutan because I couldn't handle watching it as a mother. I'm like, oh, Peter, come on, not again, really? He has the best earlobes in the industry and I spent a lot of time rubbing them. And probably the best sense of humor of any director I've ever worked with, and as a result, I think I did some of the best work I've ever done on that film because nobody was taking it too seriously, and I crack under pressure.
Where were you when you got the call? Hey, we're gonna need you for this thing.
Honestly?
Yeah.
Why would you lie about that? Tell me something that's not true, please. It's just surreal. I was laid up in bed, healing from giving birth to my child.
By the way, congratulations.
Thank you.
So you're just going, oh my God, all I need, I just need a little break. Just give me a second, catch my breath.
Okay.
Ring.
Is there anything left down there? Will I ever walk again? And then somebody said, you won't just walk, you'll kill orcs. What? Yeah. And it was pretty horrible. Like, I was in a bad way because it was 30 hours of labor. It was 8 hours of pushing.
Jesus.
Anyone who's had a baby just fainted. And it was without drugs on my patio. In a thunderstorm, in an island-wide power outage. So it was kind of surreal, and it was it was a little bit difficult, and I got really wounded in the process. I was told I almost needed to go in for surgery to repair, and then I was told there's no such thing as too much information at NerdHQ. Is that right? Say anything, right? So then I got this call. And they said, would you like to fly to New Zealand and be an elf? And
except for the part about the phone call, I think that's how Davy Crockett was born. Or some like lumberjack.
Or
some
Thor.
Point. Yeah, something. So, yes, there we go, there we go. You had a baby. Is that what? What? Here I have a book here. The Squickerwonkers. By Evangeline Lilly. What made you decide to do one of these?
Well, I have been professing to want to be a writer for a very, very long time, annoying a lot of people, especially because usually when I talk about writing, I talk about leaving acting, and my fans don't love that idea. Thankfully, they're not mutually exclusive anymore. And I happen to have written a children's story called The Squickerwonkers when I was 14 years old. And because I'm in wonderful geek company, I can admit to the fact that when I was 14 years old, sitting in my room and writing dorky poems was more attractive to me than partying with my peers. Because I'm a dork. And I wrote this poem that my mother at 14 was like, you really need to publish that. And what 14-year-old knows anything about publishing a book? So I obviously never did. 20 years later, old. 20 years later, I worked with Peter Jackson and his amazing team at the Weta Workshop, and his amazing team at the Weta Workshop were so inspiring that they were all making their projects and realizing dreams and doing exciting, creative things every day, and I was like, I want to do that. I want to realize a dream and have a project and create amazing, creative things. So I partnered with one of their artists, Johnny Fraser Allen, who illustrated this incredible book for me, and we worked our butt off for the last year, driving ourselves hard to get here this year, and we did it, and we're here. And this book is not for sale in stores, it's not for sale online, it's for sale at Comic-Con only this year, and you guys are my litmus test, because you guys hold the bar high, you know graphic stories, you've got really sophisticated taste, and I want to know what you think of my book.
Where specifically? Because Comic-Con's big. Do you know where booth 2986? Do you know that?
Oh, yeah. The Weta Workshop booth, booth 3513.
Thank you. I can find that on a map. How much did this change between the time you were 14 writing this and now? How much did it change?
Completely.
Really?
I mean, well, the plot is still the same plot. It's still the same essence. The story is the same essence. But I've rewritten and rewritten and rewritten and rewritten because when I brought it to a professional last year and said, I've got this story, what do you think? He was like, you'll never get that published. And I said, okay, well, how would I get to a place where I might be able to publish it? And he said, a lot of rewrites. I don't mean like your casual, I mean like you will have to go into the trenches. It was obviously terrible, but the good thing is the very same man a year later signed off on it and said that he believed that it was a wonderful sort of kind of revolutionary new thing for kids. So,
but not before the little 14-year-old girl inside you died a little bit.
A little bit.
A little bit, all right.
Mommy loved it.
Can I read an excerpt just to give you a little taste? Can I read this? So what do you say? The voice carried on. Will you leave or will you engage? Though the girl was suspicious, her fear felt delicious, and so she hopped upon the stage. It's a limerick. Tons of rewrites.
I love that you chose that particular verse because though the girl was suspicious, her fear felt delicious is the whole notion behind making this book because I think kids love being scared. I think big kids love being scared too. And I wanted to put it right in the book for parents to like really accentuate it and say, look, kids find this yummy. They like dark, scary stuff. Anyway, sorry, what were you saying?
Was that you when you were a kid? Did you like the scary stuff?
I hated it.
Ghost stories?
Oh my God, I hated it. I would, if kids watched scary movies when I was over at their house, I would hide in the bathroom and I would wait 2 hours till the movie was over. So no one else could pee.
I have to pee.
But for some reason, I understand that I was weird and that most kids do really love it.
There is a rush of endorphins when you feel fear. And as a child, I think that's the closest you get to being drunk. You know, it's like your first, oh my God.
Now that is an experience I enjoy.
When you were a child or?
Now.
Good. Good, because the other one's a fire hazard. How easy was it from the point you said, okay, I'm going to do this, to the point where these rewrites, is it years in process?
No, it was 1 year of, well, to explain how difficult this process was, it was only a year, but I think prematurely, some people say I'm old enough already and I should be expecting it by now, but I think prematurely, I got my first few gray hairs this year. And they occurred, I noticed them, they happened on the same month that I was not only locking this for print and trying to arrange, you know, to get it here, but I was doing reshoots on The Hobbit full time and working around the clock. And I got my first few gray hairs on this book, so please buy it.
Welcome to the club. I have my niece sit behind me like an orangutan. And she picks up gray hairs. She gets a dollar for every gray hair she pulls, but I take away two for everyone that's not gray. The system works. How did you get introduced to your illustrator, Johnny, here?
Richard Taylor, the head of Weta Workshop, is an incredibly generous man. I don't know if any of you had a chance to meet him, but he is somebody who I aspire to be like. He is incredible. And I've brought my stories to him, and I said, do you think any of your illustrators might be interested in the book? So he took two of my stories, and showed it to the illustrators. Johnny came back. He was interested. I said, great, let's start on Exhibit A. So we started on Exhibit A, and about a month into it, he was like, just so you know, I really love Exhibit B, and I've done this. And he showed me this incredible watercolor image of these marionette puppets in a wagon, with this little girl with this bright red balloon between them, and I knew immediately we were gonna change course and we were gonna do Exhibit B, because his vision for the images in this book completed the image that I had from the story, and it totally elevated it. I mean, this book, if it was just the words, would not be here today, and I wouldn't be selling it, and I wouldn't be as proud of it as Johnny's just given me something incredible in the illustrations.
Very nice. I'm being selfish. Is there another question? Someone have a microphone? Let's go with you. You have to have a microphone first. Put your hand up, get a mic. We're going to go to her first.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. It's an exceptional cause. And
you're welcome.
We appreciate it. Especially you.
Oh, you mean, long. Sorry. You mean, okay. Gotcha. Evie, thank you for being here.
Especially you, though. Got you. Your work on Lost was exceptional, and I think you're a phenomenal actress, and can't wait. Yep, you too, though.
Her? You're still talking about her?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. You'll get your moment.
I'll wait.
It's fine.
I have to say, your drooling was incredible in that final
Thank
scene.
You.
Your moment's tomorrow. If there were any show on television right now that you could be a part of, what would you be in?
If we're talking about full-time being a part of, forget about it. I'm never going back there. It's way too much work. So much. Sit down, Jack. But if we're talking about maybe like a guest starring thing, Modern Family. Oh. Modern Family. But this might be again, too much work. I'm lazy. Justified? I think Justified is amazing. Amazing.
Was that blocking your view? That's good.
How about?
We had a question over here.
Hi.
Hi.
I was a huge fan of Lost, and I'm really thrilled you're going to be in The Hobbit. Now that you've gotten to work in such beautiful places like Hawaii and New Zealand, what was like kind of awe-inspiring?
Working in Detroit with real steel?
Sorry.
No, it's fine.
I love baseball, and I love Detroit. Love them.
What were kind of big awe-inspiring moments working in Hawaii and New Zealand?
I remember this moment. Well, I mean, it happened more than once, but I remember specifically there was one time when I was working on the beach in Hawaii on the north shore of Oahu on Lost. And there was this break between setups. And, no, there wasn't a break. We were actually in the process of filming, and suddenly there were these huge whales breaching offshore, and they were so close that all of us could see them very easily with our nude eyes. And And we actually stopped filming for about 15 minutes. And for those of you who don't know, that's like, I don't know, like $50,000 down the tubes, you know, 15 minutes of just not filming or doing anything during your workday. And we just watched the whales as a group. And I remember, I think I turned to, I don't remember which co-star I was with, but I turned to one of my co-stars and I said, this is our office. This is what we come to every day. This is our job. And I'm always pinching myself and reminding myself, no matter how difficult acting can be or, you know, whatever the things that actors like to complain about, including myself, that we play house for a living. And we get paid really well to do it. And that's really cool. Speaking of that, little trivia. Do you guys know that, you know how there's like a murder of crows, or there's a school of fish, or there's a university of owls, you know, that there's these grouping names? Guess what the grouping name is for a group of actors? It's a complaint of actors. And then to finish your question, New Zealand moments that stood out, spectacular moments that stood out. Unfortunately, I'm so immersed here right now. What comes to mind, and so I'll just say it, even though there was amazing, incredible, natural, you know, experiences I had on location and that kind of stuff. But for me, the thing that stands out in my mind right now was having Fran Walsh and Philippa Boyens, who are Peter Jackson's writers, mentor me through this project. They're busy ladies. They don't have a moment to spare, but they were so enthusiastic about this book, and they came on and they helped me tweak it, and they helped me do some of those, you know, dozens of rewrites, and gave their time so graciously and generously to me, and that just stands out for me.
One more question about the illustrations, because this is, I'm loving this right now.
Thank you. Good. Keep loving it. Love.
When a publisher comes to you and says, we need another rewrite, and you have to keep coming back, does an illustrator come to you and you're looking at these beautiful artworks, do you say, nah, more hair or less spooky? Do you have that?
Yeah. And I mean, I don't know if all writers and illustrators have that relationship, but Johnny Fraser Allen was generous and kind enough to treat this the way he would treat anything he worked on at Weta Workshop, which is he treated me like the client, and he said, I want you to be happy with this end product. So he would send me ideas, and I would say yay or nay, or he would send me what he thought was a finished illustration, and he'd be really excited, and I'd go, this needs to change, or I don't want that different, and I felt like a complaint of actors. I felt like such a jerk. But I knew at the end of the day that this had to be my book, and it had to be something that I would flip through every single page and go, oh, I love this page, you have to see this page, and then flip to the next page and go, oh, no, this is my favorite page, I love this page. So that's what I've got now, and that's thanks to Johnny's generosity and allowing me to collaborate with him in that way. But, you know, with the rewrites and the illustrations, what got really tricky was he would do things that were so gosh darn gorgeous that didn't really work for the story, that I would just go change the story. Because I was like, I love this, it has to be in the book. And I rewrote the story according to the illustrations a number of times also. And then we started designing the book, and then it wouldn't work for the design, and I go back and I rewrite it again to make it work for the design. So it was very organic. Everything had to work together.
Very nice. Who has another microphone? Right here in the front. Keep calm, buddy.
Hi.
Hi.
We are all very excited to see you in The Hobbit as an elf. Did you have to learn any Elvish? And can you share it with us?
You guys want to get me fired, don't you?
We won't understand anything anyway.
So. This is Comic-Con. This is where the Elvish, fluent Elvish speakers come. The only people in the world who know Elvish are here in this room today. Okay, yes, I did have to learn, well, no, okay, I didn't have to learn the language of Elvish, which I think would be really cool if I had, but I didn't. I learned my lines in Elvish, and I would memorize them. And the thing is, if I tell you a line that I said in the movie in Elvish, it's obviously an important line, because only the important lines go to Elvish. You're going to know a plot point, and then I'm going to get fired, and then I'm going to get in trouble. So all I can give you as a peace offering is, you're gonna love this because of the guy, anyway, is Hirnin Legolas, which means my lord Legolas.
Oh.
Antale.
I was actually just wondering if there's any way any of us who couldn't make it to Comic-Con can get the book.
I love this question. I feel like I should invite you onto the stage or something for asking that question. I didn't pay her. I swear to God. Right now, well, here, let me give you the inside scoop that nobody knows at this point, but it's in my brain and it's a plan. Like honestly, not even my team know this yet. If I don't sell, this is a limited run of 1,000 books, and it's the first edition, and it's my version, not a publisher's version. So there's only 1,000 books. I physically can't get through signing 1,000 books and giving the fans the attention they deserve in the hours and hours and hours I've spent on the floor. I thought I could, and I can't. So if there's any books left over when I leave Con, I will find some way to get them to you guys through my socials, and you can go to evangelinelilly.com to find out information about the book. And then within the next 24 hours, there will be Squickerwonker web pages going up at evangelinelilly.com where you can follow news and find out when it's going to come out as a digital book, when it's going to come out in stores, and that will hopefully, fingers crossed, if all goes according to plan, be sometime around Christmas. So you can buy it for your nieces, nephews, daughters, sons, grandchildren, everyone you know.
Hi, I'm Mike.
I remember you, Mike. Oh, hi.
Yeah, thanks. You were very gracious and signed a copy of the book for me. And I've read it.
Yay.
And the first thing I'm going to do when I get home is I'm going to give it to my daughter to read because it's just really wonderful. And thanks for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
I want to talk about the elephant in the room. I'm a professor. I'm an English professor, and I've done some.
Scared all of a sudden.
Well, no, don't be. Don't.
Am I gonna get in trouble?
No, not at all.
Okay.
And I've done some presentations about Tolkien and delivered papers on Tolkien. So, no. And here's what I want to say. Here's the important thing I want to say.
Mike, sit down now, quickly. Sit down.
I know. And what I want to say is, I am not a hater.
Yay!
Okay. I want to see more Tolkien and more of his story, and I want to see a wonderfully strong female character, which there aren't a lot of them in The Hobbit. And so, and it's not your fault. And I know there are people out there, oh, it's not what Tolkien wrote. I am so excited to see it. And in the short conversation we did have, I mean, you obviously know what you're talking about. You did your homework, and you want to talk about, so can you talk about the Sylvan Elves and your experience creating a whole new character, and I'm loving it, not hating it.
Thank you, Mike. Another fan that should be in the leader panel board up here, prompting all the right questions, didn't pay him either. Didn't pay him. So here's my take on all of this stuff. I was a fan of Tolkien before Peter Jackson made the Lord of the Rings trilogy. And I swore I would not go see those movies because I swore nobody could do those books justice on screen. And then my family, who are also diehard fans, decided to make a whole group event of it during the Christmas break. So I was home visiting, home from Lost, and I had limited amount of time with my family, and they're like, we're all going to this movie. And I thought, okay, I'll come because I don't want to miss out on time with my family. And couldn't believe that he had created everything that was in my brain. Like everything I'd visioned, everything I saw when I was reading the books showed up on screen, except two things which I won't tell you because it's rude. And I loved the movies. I fell madly in love with those movies, and they're still some of my favorite movies, and I really felt that he at that point became the official shepherd of visualizing, you know, creating visual images of Tolkien's work. So when I got that call when I was sliced in half laying in bed, I I was hesitant, you know, of course, when they said that she's not in the book. I thought, oh, I'm going to get in a lot of trouble for this. And then I just took about 5 seconds to realize that I think Peter Jackson's earned the right to take creative liberties and to represent the world the way he best feels it would be represented. And the thing about The Hobbit, I went back, it was my favorite book when I was little. And when I went back and reread it for the role, I realized it is a very simple, linear children's story that isn't really complex enough for the screen. It would be boring. No offense to Tolkien, it's awesome as a book, but it would be boring as a movie if it didn't get filled out in a way. And he wrote in a time when men were excused for not having women in their stories because women were a subclass of citizens at that point. Women are no longer a subclass of citizens, and we should be represented in all of the stories that are told on screen and in books. The other thing is, the Sylvan Elves are talked about in The Hobbit, and I know this because they were my favorite part of The Hobbit, even though they were only featured a little bit. But my favorite part of The Hobbit when I was a little girl was when the lights would go off in Mirkwood, the little flickering lights, and they'd hear the music of the Sylvan Elves dancing and singing and celebrating, and the dwarves got, you know, taken off the path because they were enchanted by these elves. I was completely enchanted by these elves. I would have given anything to be a Sylvan Elf, and now I am one. And somebody in the movies had to represent that group of people, because you don't care about a group of people until you know one of them. And now you're gonna know one of them. I'm done. I'm off my soapbox. We're friends again.
Pick the next question. There's a couple people out there with microphones.
Hi. Wait.
Start with L.
You were supposed to tell me. She has such a pretty name, and I've seen her twice, and I can't, every time I'm like, I want to remember that delicious name, and I can't remember it. It's as pretty as she is. Anyways, go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Lavinia.
Lavinia. Isn't that nice? Lavinia.
Well, Evangeline is much nicer.
Yeah. No, it's not. Okay.
Okay, my question is, one sentence of the book goes like, and this is the first of this Squeer tale. So do you plan on having more books about this story?
This is, on the board, you're on the board. this is the first of what I hope will be a series of graphic children's storybooks. And when I say graphic children's storybooks, I think I made up that title. I don't think that's actually a legitimate title yet. Because you guys at Con have to help me, because I don't know the graphic storybook world very well at all. But I don't know of any children's graphic storybooks. I know of graphic novels that are designed for like young adults and for adults and for teenagers. But do any of you know of a graphic storybook that's designed for little kids? Crickets. I love it. So that's what I'm trying to do with this. I think that kids should be introduced to graphic storybooks sooner because they're the best books in the world. And I love looking at visual images as much as a 4-year-old does. And so these will hopefully be 18 books. There will be the demise of the Squickerwonkers and the origins of the Squickerwonkers. And they will come in that order, even though it's the reverse order to the chronology of a human life. And that's uncomfortable, and that's why I want to do it that way. And hopefully, if this one's successful, we'll have the second one at Comic-Con next year.
I think the bandana has my attention.
Bandana.
Hi, my name's Indy. We're actually from Canada as well.
Yay!
Toronto, definite hockey fans. I'm going to buy that book, I think, after this panel for my 3 kids.
Thank you. Hope it's appropriate
for young ones as well. I'm just wondering if there's your huge, you know, big fan, Lost, Hobbit, huge productions. Is there any specific actor or actress you would love to work with that you haven't yet, even if it's in Detroit or it's a baseball movie? Or...
but that's actually like a good parallel, because one of the main reasons I worked in Detroit was because I had an incredible amount of respect for Hugh Jackman, and I had told myself about a year before I got offered that role, I would really like to work with Hugh Jackman. I loved him in The Fountain by Darren Aronofsky. I thought he blew himself out of the water. I mean, that guy's performance in that film told the world, in my mind, that he was much bigger than just a, you know, pop star icon, that he was a true artist and a true actor. Anyway, tangent. If I had to just come up with an answer, and of course there's always, you could think about it afterwards and you think of seven other people you wish you'd said, but Woody Allen is somebody that's on the top of my list to work with. I love what he does. I love his style. And Diane Keaton, who of course was Annie Hall, it's just been, she's somebody who I idolize because of that. And she's the only person in Hollywood I've ever geeked out over at an awards ceremony and embarrassed myself severely. So I'm gonna say Woody Allen and Diane Keaton.
Where's the other, microphone over there, stand up.
Hi.
Hi.
Where's your baby?
Yeah, he's
at Isaiah,
home.
Right? Isaiah?
Elijah. Yeah. yeah, I'm Allie. And first of all, I just want to thank you for being here and just, you know, all of that. I just really enjoyed meeting you. And I thought 18 hours without medication was difficult, so I commend you for that. I was just wondering if you could talk about how, like, you balance being a mom and being an actor, and then now writing children's books, and how that all comes into play. You know, now being a mom and how that all comes.
Being a really new mom, I think I am the farthest thing from an authority on the topic. I'm learning that. I actually spent, because the last 2 or 3 months of this project coincided with doing the reshoots for The Hobbit, and I was literally working around the clock. I felt like I was failing miserably at that for the last couple months, and I spent a lot of time when I was eating or asleep, because that's the only time I had to think about other things other than the book and The Hobbit, other than the Squickerwonkers and The Hobbit, I mean. I spent a lot of time thinking about how I would do that. How do I move forward and forge a path that allows me to create all the things I want to create and do all the things I want to do professionally while also being as present as I'd like to be for my children. I'd always dreamed of homeschooling my kids. I'm passionate about children, and I've worked with children since I was 14 years old. So I think I'm still learning that, and I wish I had a more succinct answer for you, but I really don't. Right now, I just depend completely on the incredible foundation that is my partner, and he has generously left his job to be the security and be the stability in our home so that I can realize my dreams. And without him, this wouldn't have been made. I wouldn't have been in the house. I would have been at home with my children, because that would have been my first, with my child, because that would have been my first priority. But I can lean on him. And I think to have a guy who doesn't feel emasculated by that is a very rare gift, and I'm very blessed and very grateful for it.
What happens when your child grows up and you say...
Gets chest hair.
And you say, I'm going to read you a book. And you read him this book and he goes, Mom, that's scary, man. Don't read that book to me anymore.
I'll relate. I was that little girl. Somebody said, does being a mom change like how you approach children's storybook writing? And I was like, I don't know, man, because I can't read it to him yet. I try, and he gets bored. He's two. He's like, Mom, can we move on? That's a long book, and he doesn't get it. But he does, whenever I'm working on the book or talking about the book, he'll just walk into the room and go, Squickerwonkers. And it melts my heart.
Who has the mic now? Where are we looking? Where are we looking? Please.
Hi, thanks so much for coming. I was just wondering, given kind of the tone of the book or what it looks like, if you were a fan of Tim Burton, and if so, which of his movies are your favorite?
I'm a big fan of Tim Burton, and the kind of the main thing I like about Tim Burton is that Tim Burton has never apologized for being Tim Burton. And I imagine it was hard for Tim Burton to get anyone to believe that what he was doing was something that could be marketed, that could be marketable. And people are so afraid in the content industry right now of anything that's different, because everyone is hemorrhaging money in that industry while the internet sorts itself out and while a lot of people steal a lot of art, which I don't agree with. Although I do love the idea of art sharing for free. I mean, there's all these politics. I won't get into them. But I do love his work. I think it's beautiful, and a favorite?
Top three.
Well, no, I think I'm gonna go straight back to Nightmare Before Christmas, because it was the first time that I ever, yeah. It was the first time that I think we got invited into his brain, and it was a very exciting place to be, and that first blush of meeting a new artist and experiencing them, I don't think you can really eclipse that for me. Yeah.
Very nice. Who's got another microphone out there?
Brianna does.
Hi. First of all, I just wanted to say thank you so much for making my weekend so amazing. Like, you've been so much nicer to me than you need to be, and you're just great to all your fans, and a lot of people are.
I got so scared when you said that. I thought you were going to say you were so much nicer to me than Nathan Fillion was.
I haven't even met her yet. Give me a chance, Brianna.
Okay.
Give me a chance.
My question is, you've affected a lot of females by doing your strong roles and just by being like a very yourself person in the media. And what is your, like, how do you feel about that? And, like, was there ever a moment where it hit you that that was a reality?
Yeah, when I started on Lost, I made a commitment to myself that for the duration of that show, as long as I was physically capable of doing it, I would respond to every single fan letter that came to me by hand myself. And I did for 4 years. And by season 5, it was the boxes were so piled up, I couldn't keep up. So I would just do what I could, but I didn't get to everybody by that season. And that was how I started to realize what was happening out there, was I would get these incredible letters from women and girls at the time, like Brianna, that would say things like, you know, I am stronger because of you, or I am freer to be myself because I believe that's what you're doing. Or, you know, there's just different ways that people would say that I was becoming a role model for them. And before I started the job on Lost, I was studying political science and international relations in Vancouver at the University of British Columbia because I wanted to be a missionary. And then I became a Hollywood actress. I mean, and what was amazing when I read those letters was I realized somehow through this strange twist of events that happened outside of my control, I was still having a positive influence on people. I was impacting people in a meaningful way. And I'd never thought that television could do that. I didn't know that television could do that. And then I saw that happening. And I mean, I would read letters that would make me cry, and I would read letters that would make me angry because people weren't being treated right in the world. And I felt like suddenly I realized there was this beautiful responsibility that I had. And I'm honored to carry that load. I feel very blessed by the amount of people who somehow, through whatever I'm doing, have been able to grow and become a better, stronger person because of it.
Who has it? Stand up.
Hi, I'm Debbie. And
hi, Debbie.
Hi.
Elijah's grandma.
Yeah. Anyway, I was wondering, that the book seems to, you already said, you know, just kind of tacking on to some other questions, but you've already said you've got some ideas for, you know, multiple, you know, books in a series. And when I read it this afternoon, it seemed like it lent itself to like a children's sort of novel or illustrated novel, and I was wondering if you have any plans to expand it to that, maybe make it into like a screenplay or you know, that kind of thing, so, or a movie.
Later panel. I Tim Burton's name came up when we were making this book because Johnny Fraser Allen admires him also. Gris Grimley came up because Johnny Fraser Allen also admires him and introduced me to him. I'd never even heard of him until Johnny showed me his work, and can't believe I didn't know who he was before that. But we have, of course, all of these, you know, cherry on the top of the sundae ideas of what this could become and what we would love to do with it, you know, making, I mean, a stop animation movie of this book would be the best stop animation movie you've ever seen, or of not necessarily even just of the book, but of the series. Because the series is serial, it would lend itself to a children's television show. The merchandising opportunities are outrageous. Johnny Fraser Allen already made a Pup of the Proud sculpt that was with us at the signing table. I don't know if you got a chance to see it. It's beautiful. And the problem is that we haven't sold the book yet. So you can't really think that. You know, you really, well, for me, I don't want to get my hopes up and then have them dash. So I keep focusing on what's the next step, what's the next thing. And the next thing is, somehow managing to get people to be interested in the book and have them go out and buy it, and if they do, then yeah, that would be an amazing place to go. And Richard Taylor of the Weta Workshop has already told me that if I could scrape up the money, they're in first in line to do the stop animation film.
Very clever then, bringing it to Comic-Con, limited run, making it not only collectible, you can only get it here. Very, very clever. We have time for one more.
Are you trying to get on the leaderboard?
Trying. You're not making it
easy.
You have
to be nicer to Brianna. If you
do know. I? I love what you've done with your hair.
Me too. It looks like Tauriel's hair.
Hello, I'm Christina.
Hello.
Thank you so much for being here. This is so awesome. Huge Lost fan, obviously. Just curious, what was your favorite episode of film? And at the end, did you take anything from the set?
Of Lost?
Yeah. We won't tell.
Well, my favorite, I don't have, everyone, I've been asked this a lot. I don't have a favorite episode, but I'll boil it down. My favorite season was season one, and in season one, my favorite episode, which you guys can tell me the name of because I've forgotten right now, is the one where Boone dies and Claire gives birth to Aaron. What's that one called? Somebody knows it.
I don't know it. I'm embarrassed.
It's not called Boone Dies. You're on the followers board. There's no leaderboard for you, Boone Dies. That was my favorite episode of that season, which was my favorite season. And did I take anything from the set? I took the first original on-set, on-camera, Dear Mr. Sawyer letter. I thought so. And then my house burned down with the letter in it. Love it. I love it. You guys, I would have waited for 7 hours in line for that letter. How could you let it burn? Do no harm. Leaderboard. Ding, 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 ding.
Boone, no harm. Good job. Evangeline, thank you so much for joining us and donating your time and helping us today.
Can I come back?
Yes.
Thank you.
I'm doing two panels tomorrow. You're welcome to both.
Whose panels am I photobombing?
Mine.
You and Zach.
Yeah, I guess.
Oh, I should crash that.
He can come too if he likes.
I should totally crash that. That'd be a good one to crash.
You're always very giving of yourself, and you always have so much of yourself to give. Thank you for sharing with us. Thank you for being here today. Ladies and gentlemen, Evangeline Lilly. We'll be right back.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, here's what we're going to do. From that pillar right here, these two back rows, you guys stand up here, go out that way.